Welcome to Art Advertising, welcome to Chartwell Booksellers. My name is Barry Singer and I'm the proprietor of Chartwell Booksellers, which is right over there, and you'll meet Chartwell Booksellers after this is over. We will be serving some light refreshments right in front of us. I'll just answer one question that occurs to me. I'm sure you're asking yourselves, why would Winston Churchill's sport devoted to the works of Winston Churchill be interested in Pennsylvania Station and rebuilding it? And the answer is twofold and very quick. One is that Winston Churchill passed through Pennsylvania Station many, many times. In all of his visits to the United States on his way to Fulton, Missouri to deliver the Iron Curtain speech, he passed through Pennsylvania Station. He was very familiar with it. So it does seem appropriate. I have photographs of him and his wife in Pullman cars pulling out of Penn Station. The second reason is personal. I have always been interested in Penn Station since I was a kid. I never saw it, but I was fascinated by it to the point that I ultimately went out and tried to find whoever it was who tore it down. It fascinated me that it was the name who tore it down, but I couldn't imagine who they might be. And I ultimately discovered that it was a guy named Irving Mitchell Felt. Maybe this is something that you all know. But I was so passionate about this that I decided I wanted to ask Mr. Felt, who I learned was still alive, this was about 25 years ago, why he did this. And one day I was in the store thinking about it, and I thought, maybe he's in the phone book. And I opened the phone book. In those days, you could, and there was Irving Felt. I called the number. I got a Los Angeles home, and they said to me, oh, Mr. Felt is in New York. You can reach him at the Regency Hotel. I called him at the Regency Hotel. They put me right in the room, and he answered the phone. He was quite old, and when I told him that I was a journalist, which I was and still am, as well as a bookseller, which I didn't mention, and that I was interested in why, in the story behind the tearing down of Penn Station, he said to me, that is my most proud, the proudest achievement of my life. And he proceeded to spend 2 hours telling me about why what he did was so important to the city and was something that he was so proud of. He ultimately invited me to come visit him at the Regency and asked me to ghostwrite his memoirs for him. It's crazy. And I went to see him there and he told me the entire saga, but he wouldn't let me use a ticket. And I must say, it is quite a saga. It starts with him wanting to buy Madison Square Garden, the old garden, from the mob and Frank Costello, who ran it and owned it at the time, were being forced out because of the Kefauver Commission. He did buy the garden, and then he needed a place to put it, and he put together the fact that the Pennsylvania Railroad was in trouble and might be willing to sell, and ultimately approached them about buying it. He was very proud of this and shared this with them. And ultimately, he came to an agreement with them, he said, but the missing factor in terms of money, he was worried about, he didn't have enough financing. And he shared with me something that I don't know that I've seen from anywhere else, which is that he said David Rockefeller called him out of the blue. He didn't know David Rockefeller. And he said, I hear what you're doing, come and talk to me. And he said, David Rockefeller provided him with money to finish tearing down the acquisition of Penn Station, and ultimately to tear it down, because he believed that the car was the future and highways needed to be built and the railway system needed to be de-emphasized. So that's why we're here tonight, to rectify this horrific crime that was committed by these guys in the name of progress. And I was thrilled that Sam Turvey, who's a customer, mentioned to me at some point his interest in Penn Station, the interest that we share, and I invited him here tonight with all of the people who are determined to see this happen. We don't realize it's a long shot, but it does seem like an excellent idea. I'd like to introduce one of these gentlemen to you. His name is Justin Shubow. He's the president of the National Civic Art Society. He's just been appointed to the U.S. Commission in Fine Arts. And he will begin this evening formally. Justin.
Thank you, Barry, and thanks to Chartwell Booksellers for hosting this incredible event. The nonprofit I named the National Civic Arts Society, we're inspired by one of the great lines of Winston Churchill, which is, we shape our buildings, and thereafter our buildings shape us. In short, we believe that public art and architecture, our monuments, memorials, civic buildings, public buildings like those of Pennsylvania Station, play what you might call a moral and political role in society. They do shape who we are, and they speak to who we are as equals in a democratic society. At least they do so appropriately if they're building like the original Pennsylvania Station. The National Civic Arts Society, we are headquartered in Washington, D.C., but have a national purview. We advocate for classical and traditional public art and architecture, looking back to the founding fathers who consciously chose a classical style to embody America's democracy, and would like to see that tradition continue in the rebuilding of Pennsylvania Station. We came to this idea a little bit, I guess in 2016, we learned of Richard Cameron, who is speaking tonight. Richard is one of the best architects in America, and he had this brilliant idea of rebuilding the original extension. And we decided to make this on the arts, and then created a steering committee headquartered here in New York, which is chaired by Senator Turvey, who will speak next. But thank you very much.
Some of you may ask me, or may wonder, why am I interested in Penn Station? And I will tell you that my interest started a long time ago. I was in high school, maybe a freshman, and I bought this book for one of my brothers for Christmas. And I bought it because when I picked this book up in a bookstore, I got an immediate spiritual jolt looking at this train concourse of the original Penn Station, which if some of you don't know where it's located, this is the 8th Avenue side of the station. And I get that same jolt many mornings as I walk diagonally through Grand Central Station. And I would say to you that the architecture of the original Penn Station and Grand Central Station and Union Station in Washington, D.C. and Union Station in Denver creates a spiritual jolt for me anytime I go through those buildings, and it is a jolt that will be the envy of any religion. And so, when I learned that there is an emerging consensus in New York City that something needs to be done for the Pennsylvania Station, and that there is a group that thought we should contemplate rebuilding the original Penn Station, I determined that even if that doesn't happen, I am going to dedicate a substantial amount of my time and money towards that cause, because I feel that nothing that is presently before the city of New York would do more for its brand, its economy, its ecology, and countless other things than rebuilding that station. We don't just believe and rebuilding the original Penn Station. You hear from a group called Rethink New York City tonight, and some homeowners know that as your basement goes, so goes the rest of your house. Well, in a train station, the tracks are a little more important than a basement of a house, but we feel that we need to really radically address the transit congestion in the region, and that there are a lot of inefficiencies in the way Penn Station is presently utilized. I won't steal ReThink's thunder, but their basic premise is that it should become 100% through station. There should not be trains that come in from New Jersey and go back empty. There should not be trains that come in from Long Island and sit in a yard on the west side. They should continue out to Jersey and take people who might want to live in Long Island City and work in Secaucus or Jersey City, and there might be people in New Jersey who might want to work in different parts of Queens and Long Island. Something really like to see that. So I already mentioned that there's an emerging consensus that we need to do something about connection. And the second part of that consensus, many people ask me this, Madison Square Garden needs to move. Barry met somebody who, I don't know what sort of ego problems they had, but the idea of sticking a basketball arena, an entertainment center on top of a train station for a major international city does not make any sense. There is, and there's going to be a lot of pressure on real estate in this city, but there are public spaces that need to be protected and preserved, and the land over Penn Station will be. The other thing I think that we all agree, not only do we think something should be done about Penn Station, but it's painfully obvious to any of us who are doing a rush job, we should have a world-class train station in that location. It should not be the terrible joke that it is. Embarrassment that frankly is a national disgrace and a lot worse. So our position, and Richard and the Rethink people will get you, will fill out the proofs, is we believe the original Penn Station, the drawings of which are at the New York Historical Society, should be rebuilt with as much fealty to the original design and language as possible. We feel, as I said, that none of the other proposals, whether it's the governor's idea of putting a glass wall on 8th Avenue to frame the Farley Post Office, or Bashan Chakrabarty's idea of shading the garden in glass with a translucent map of the city on top, we don't think they will realize the true economic benefit of that space, and they will not have the impact of the brand on New York City that can and should happen there. It is staring us right in the face. So, why the original? Let me talk that through a little. I'll talk in terms of something old, something borrowed, and something new. How many of you were ever in the original Penn Station? There's a woman in the back who is not raising her hand, and her name is Lorraine Deal, and she wrote a book called The Late Great Penn Station, and most of you have probably seen it over here, but if you have not, look it up, because it is the seminal work on the station. But, the original Penn Station was the pier of Grand Central Station. And for those of you who don't know too much about it, we'll just go through it quickly. If you look at the drawing from the far right, that was the 7th Avenue South. That's now a neon light where you can enter Madison Square Garden. The central waiting room is the next picture. It's 150 feet high, mounted on the Roman baths and Caracalla. It's a beautiful space. Clever story windows everywhere, natural light everywhere. We already mentioned the train concourse, which is far to the left. And on the farthest left, and we'll talk about that in a little bit, is there are carriageways on the north and south side of the station. But it was a station of many rooms that revealed itself in many ways. And while it was built for national train traffic and Long Island Railroad commuting traffic in 1910, it certainly is Grand Central crews. Is something that could be retrofitted with today's use, and we certainly would like to see that happen. As to something borrowed, I've already told you about ReThinks ideas on transit, and here's something about that. And the thing you should know is we are not zealots. We are not saying that every scrap of materials and workmanship of the original Penn Station needs to be recreated. But we want it to be the starting point, and we don't like faux recreations, and we don't like dishonest compromises. What I would say is, if you look closely at some of these renderings, they actually are what we would do with a modern Penn Station. We have some walls that had false columns and have been opened up to increase circulation. Those carriageways that originally would take you down to the concourse level, Homeland Security would never let you do that these days. So we repurposed them as pedestrian walkways and open-air arcades, a very interesting approach to street life in New York City. We are in the process of working towards a competition for a design complementary to the original Penn Station, but retrofitted for its current uses, and we're very excited about that. Some of you may say, well, how in the heck of the world could we afford to do something like that? Well, the fact of the matter is they are going to do something there. They can throw good money after bad into a partial solution. They can throw okay money after okay solution, or they can do something that's truly inspiring. The half station, I can't pronounce as an NP architect, but I think most of you know that cost $4.5 billion. And unfortunately, we seem to build train stations with the idea that they have to be malls. I understand the need for retail space, but there's more to spirituality than retail space. We think that the rebuilding the original Penn Station could cost $3.5 billion. Now, in New York City, everything could be more than that, but it is not beyond the pale that that space in that location would be worthy, not of that expense, but that investment. Think of what the High Line did to that neighborhood. And think of what a rebuilt Penn Station with a reconfigured transit plan that gives us the kind of transit and train experience they have in Europe would do to this entire region. It is truly breathtaking and something to really think about. So before I pass the baton to Rethink, I did want to say something else about a train station like a Penn Station. It says something about you. It says something about your city. When you are in Grand Central, the whole station ekes out that the people who run that station care about every detail of your experience while you were in that station. The current Penn Station does not suffer from that. So I would close by saying the original Penn Station was something the city could be very proud of. And on very important days, it stood vigil for us in a very substantial way. When you get to look at the photographs in the back, I was able to discover with a friend of mine named Dale Parent, whose uncle Bob was a prominent jazz and other photographer, and we were looking for pictures of Penn Station. There was one that said Penn Station Civil Rights Movement. So we put the negatives up, and I said, okay, so there are people on the platform on August 28th, 1963. Okay, interesting. But we looked a little further, and we found a track marker that looked up towards the train concourse glassworks. And I looked careful with one of those little things. And you will see the photographs are in the back. It says New York March on Washington for Civil Rights. And you'll see 615 on that track marker. And all of a sudden the picture, both Dale and I were somewhat stunned when we saw that. I've Googled every Penn Station image there is. I have never seen that. And so it's just terrific to think that on that day, there were so many New Yorkers who went to Washington, and the organizers of that event really wanted the people to get to Washington that day and leave that night. They didn't want people sticking around, getting into trouble, anything, taking any risks, what proved to be just an absolutely terrific day. And so I would close by saying that, you know, they went and saw Martin Luther King give the I Have a Dream speech, which, you know, there's that in the Gettysburg Address, as far as I'm concerned, and little else. And while Martin Luther King wasn't a railroad man, he certainly walked right out on the third rail of the racial divide in this country and extended the conversation in a way that we all still benefit from. When he was murdered, his friend Ralph Abernathy said, "When Martin was alive, our lives were filled with meaning." Now, I don't equate our movement with Penn Station, with the civil rights movement. It is and remains the central issue that needs to be resolved in this country. But in our own sweet way, doing something that would greatly increase the brand and the effectiveness and the desirability of people living in this most tolerant city, probably in the world, is very much in keeping with what Dr. King wanted to see happen. And so I thank you, and I will just close with one last thing. We received a check recently from Dale Parent, Bob's nephew, and I was surprised both at the size of the check and the fact that he was doing this for us because he allowed him to use the negatives. And Justin Shubow from National Civic Arts Society calls me up and says, "We got a check for $828.63. Is that how much the photo printing cost?" I said, "Well, maybe. Let me check with Dale, but I don't think it cost that much." So I sent to Dale, who's got a good sense of humor. I said, "What is this?" And he said, "Sam, that's August 28th, 1963. And that was his way of saying, thanks for getting the photos up, thanks for he and I discovering them, and thanks for a great effort. So I think you'll be very interested to hear what some of us have to say, and we're going to have a lovely event afterwards, so please stick around.
So let me quickly introduce myself. My name is Barry Caro. Thank you to Sam for that. I don't see where you went, Sam. But I am with ReThinkStudio. And what we are working on is a proposal to make the transit system in New York as a whole operate in a far more efficient, far more modern fashion. We haven't really changed the fundamental way that the commuter railroads in New York work since they were opened 100 years ago. There's been a lot of advances in how we think about transit planning in that time, and it's about time that our network reflects that. In the same way that Paris invested in its network to build a system similar to what we're proposing, in the same way that London is currently investing in its network to build a system that is the inspiration, really, for what we're talking about here, which is through running. So I'm gonna show you a quick video introduction. It'll be about 2 minutes, so that you can get a sense of what we're proposing on the operational level, which is a sort of a bedrock part of the Penn Station proposal that Rebuild is talking about. I'll go into then a little bit more detail about how that would actually work, and then I'm gonna turn it over to Richard Cameron, who's gonna give you a lot more detail about how the Rebuild Penn Station effort would work in a real way. So with no further ado, here's a quick introductory video that should tell you a bit about what we're thinking.
New York City has the best public transportation in the country, but it's built around getting people in and out of Manhattan. Any other kind of trip is much harder to make. That's a big limitation for millions of people living in the tri-state area. What if the whole region were connected the way Manhattan is? We'd expand opportunities for jobs, housing, and businesses all over the region, which is especially important as populations outside Manhattan continue to grow. This can be a reality, and Rethink NYC has a plan to make it happen. Right now, we have plenty of transit systems, but they only connect to each other in a few places. Anyone commuting at Penn Station can tell you that transfers aren't easy to make. Our plan allows these transit systems to operate together. With a few targeted changes, it's possible to get from anywhere to everywhere and unlock our region's full potential. Here's how it works. Instead of being the last stop on the line, trains run through Penn Station and on to new transit hubs outside Manhattan. Passengers will have many more transfer points, and no hub will be overloaded. Next, these hubs will connect every suburban transit line, which improves transit into Manhattan and between outlying areas. The result? Every branch of the system comes together in one central trunk line. It's New York's regional unified network, RUN. RUN radically changes the way people get around the tri-state area. Commuters from upstate New York and Connecticut have multiple options. The Bronx has a major transit hub. The Sunnyside hub improves transit for millions and attracts business development. Penn Station is much less chaotic, and suburban New Jersey has robust public transit options. Plus, delays no longer hang up the whole system. Riders will almost always have an alternative route. This vision of the future is possible. Transit improvement plans and budgets are already in place. If we work together and pool our resources, we can build a world-class system that unites the entire region. RUN. From anywhere to everywhere.
So that gives you a sense of what we're really thinking of here. And the key is called through running, which is what Sam referred to earlier. How many, just to get a show of hands, how many people here live in Long Island? Anybody? Decent number. How many in New Jersey? Okay, and how many in Westchester or Connecticut? Okay, so we've got folks from all three of the major suburban regions of New York here today. And the reason, the primary reason that Midtown Manhattan exploded into the dominant center of commerce in the New York region is that it is the only place in the entire tri-state that you can get to from every other part of the tri-state region. You can't get to Lower Manhattan from the rest of the tri-state for the most part. You can only get there on the New York City subway, but you can't get there on regional rail easily. You can't get to the Upper East Side, the Upper West Side, LaGuardia, JFK, Newark. You can only get here from everywhere. And so when we think of the core business district, we think of Midtown Manhattan for that reason. And when you look at the sort of planning paradigm that sprung up around that, it is based on that idea of The transit project that Chris Christie canceled was called Access to the Region's Core, getting people to here. Our concept is slightly different. We need to expand the core, not just get people into the existing core. When we expand the core, we expand opportunities and we make the system as a whole work better. When you have a single destination point, it overloads that destination point almost by definition. And the network as a whole can work far more efficiently and effectively if it's bringing people to multiple destinations. And so that is what we're looking to do. And luckily for us, there is a once-in-a-generation investment that might happen in the New York region right now. That's called the Gateway Program. The idea of the Gateway Program is you have the two tunnels that exist under the Hudson River were badly damaged by Hurricane Sandy. They're going to have to be closed at some point in the near future in order to repair them. Just like the L train is going to be shut down next year, they're going to have to do the same thing to the existing tunnels. If you don't have new tunnels in place by then, it's going to create an absolute nightmare for basically every single person on the west side of the Hudson River and anybody who wants to get to Midtown Manhattan, period. So the idea behind Gateway is you build new infrastructure, two new tunnels get you a total of four tunnels under the Hudson River, plus all the infrastructure you need in order to run trains into those tunnels. Because as anyone who's gone through Penn Station knows, it's at absolute madhouse capacity today as currently designed. So what we've worked on is, with that Gateway budget, can you achieve the kind of through-running system that London's building with Crossrail, that Paris built with the RER, on the same budget, the same time frame, with the same agencies, within the same footprint of Penn Station that currently exists? And the answer to that is yes, you can. Because building a new terminal next to Penn Station that's called Penn Station South is just so expensive. That's part of the Gateway program. That's a $7 to $8 billion investment that would allow you to run new NJ Transit service under the Hudson River once you've got these new tunnels. What we've said is, don't build that. Make the station that you already have work better. Optimize your current assets, and at the same time, you can serve those NJ Transit passengers you would be serving at Penn Station South, while also adding the ability to run more trains for Metro North, more trains for Long Island Railroad, and fundamentally changing the passenger experience in the existing Penn Station, which anyone who's ever gone through there can tell you is an absolute nightmare. And so we're going to explain, there's a couple of videos that show exactly how that works and what it would mean at the platform and track level to have a system like this.
Our single region is split by three transit agencies. New Jersey Transit, terminating at Penn Station and Hoboken. Long Island Railroad, also terminating at Penn Station. And Metro North, terminating at Grand Central and disconnected to the two other systems. Despite the fact that Penn Station has capability to be an efficient through station, it is underutilized as a terminal for NJ Transit and LIRR, creating great inefficiencies. While there are several bottlenecks that our proposal will deal with, Penn Station is most paramount. Currently, during morning rush hour, NJ Transit trains arrive into Penn Station using tracks 1 through 12 and disembark all passengers. Some of these trains continue empty to Sunnyside, Queens, where they are stored until the evening rush hour. Of the remaining trains, some pick up passengers and return to New Jersey. Any trains leaving towards New Jersey from tracks 1 through 12 have to cross with oncoming traffic. And likewise, trains entering must compete with trains departing. The Long Island Railroad uses tracks 13 through 21, with the majority of trains continuing to the West Side yards. Other trains head back to Long Island, many times blocking each other. Because of the high amount of LIRR trains that need to enter Penn Station, LIRR uses the Southeast River Tunnel as well. All these back and forth movements become even less manageable once Amtrak, using the center platforms, enters the picture. Amtrak's operation also includes service through the Empire Connection to the north. The current gateway proposal would do nothing to alleviate the congestion caused by back-and-forth train movements. Rather, it would complicate movements further by adding 7 terminating tracks south of existing Penn Station. The construction of Penn Station South would also require the demolition of a whole Midtown block to the south of Penn, and by terminating at Penn, deny the region access to the rest of the city. A much better solution is to operate Penn Station as a through station, which is much more efficient than a terminal. The construction of the gateway tunnels would allow a symmetric flow of train traffic, with Queens-bound trains flowing only through the south half, and New Jersey-bound trains flowing through the north half of the station.
So, just to be clear here, what that is, I don't want to get too technical on this because I could get very technical on this. But what happens is that right now, it takes basically forever for a train to come in, let everybody off, check it for sleeping passengers, switch the conductors around and the drivers around to the opposite end, and then they announce on the big board what track you're on, then everybody elbows their way to get down to the tracks, and then it leaves. That whole process takes about half an hour on average between NJ Transit and Long Island Railroad. By contrast, a train that just keeps going in the same direction, you can get that done in under 5 minutes. So that's just way, way more efficient use of the existing space down there. Basically, you're no longer using Penn Station as the world's most valuable parking lot for trains. It's the most valuable real estate in the entire US. It should be treated that way in terms of train operations. And that's what this would allow you to do. Because once you no longer need to give trains 30 minutes to just sit there in the station, you can reallocate track space from tracks to platforms. And this video is going to show you exactly what that would mean for your commute and your experience getting to and from the concourse level at Penn Station, which is currently the single worst part of Penn Station. Even worse than just the concourses themselves is the nightmare of getting down or up from the tracks to the concourses.
Much of New York's transit issues are focused on Penn Station. Penn Station has 2 disjointed levels providing access to trains. Both these levels are intolerably crowded due to the narrower platforms below. Narrower platforms cause dangerous overcrowding and lack space for sufficient stairs and escalators. By implementing efficient train movements discussed in the Rethink NYC plan, half the tracks become redundant. Removing them gives us the space to widen each platform and provide the opportunity to triple the number of stairs and escalators. Now we can quickly move people between the platforms and the concourses and reduce the overcrowding that characterizes the existing station. Furthermore, by having access on both sides of a train, passengers can exit to one direction and board from another. This further improves flow and reduces stop time. Now we have a fast, safe, and comfortable experience for commuters. While widening the platforms helps with passenger flow in the existing station, we can also simultaneously lengthen the platforms to fully take advantage of Penn's current expansion. The planned Moynihan Concourse can only access the central platforms, but by absorbing the underutilized mail platform below the expansion, we can extend all platforms fully under the proposed Moynihan Station Concourse, as well as allowing more platform access and train capacity. Since our plan does not affect the structure layout of the station, any architectural proposal above ground is feasible. We can all agree that the current station is woefully deficient for the needs of the city, but we must also recognize Penn Station needs much more than a cosmetic makeover. Its improvement is also dependent on functional and holistic planning. And that is what Rethink NYC is providing.
So that is going to be the last sort of multimedia eye show before I hand it over to Richard in a couple in a couple moments. But I think what we're really looking at here as Rethink Studios is that you need to be able to get around the entire region. That is one of the things we're seeing, particularly in the sort of new economy, is the ability, for those of you who raise your hand being from Long Island, the ability to get to Newark Airport or a Giants game, or for your kids to get to Rutgers or Princeton or Fairleigh Dickinson or anywhere else. That is something that is absolutely essential to the functioning of the New York metro region, for it to be able to operate as a single region rather than as three disjointed regions plus the city. And the same thing works in reverse. If you're from New Jersey and you've ever wanted to get to a Mets game or a Yankee game or JFK, this would give you a one-seat ride to all three of those destinations. Or if you want to get to the Hamptons, it gives you a one-seat ride to the Hamptons or the Jersey Shore from the opposite sides of the river. So sort of all of the amenities that you sort of can't access in the New York region, you can access with a system that works like this. And at the same time, when you have a train station that operates in an efficient manner, those kinds of daily delays for no reason would become a thing of the past. The Long Island Railroad and New Jersey Transit schedules are cruel jokes on the commuters. And part of that is because of the complexity of the operations at Penn Station. By really simplifying the way Penn Station works, you can dramatically improve the reliability of the service that you actually provide so that people can rely on it and not have to budget in an extra 30 minutes every day and not have to budget getting to the station an hour early so that they can make it down to the platforms on time and make sure they're at the front of the line to force their way on. This is a new way of thinking about the region and a better way. And with that, it also allows you to have a much better station. As we said at the end, our proposal is compatible with anything that happens above the track and concourse level. We think you need a world-class station there. And with that, I am going to hand it over to Richard as I load his PowerPoint for him.
Thank you, and thank you to Barry for putting this on, this exhibition, and giving us this venue to talk about this idea. The beginning of this really started when the Moynihan Station Project was announced back in 1991, 92. And I think it occurred to me at the time that while it's a great idea, and I still think it's a great idea, that the possibility existed that we could, in fact, bring back the original station, that it wasn't such an outrageous idea that that could happen. So I'm going to take you through a kind of visual argument for that and hopefully create some converts out of it, or at least if not some converts, people to argue with. This quote from Daniel Burnham, "Make no small plans, they do not have the power to move men's hearts," is this view of the country at night. Leads me to this, which is the original 1811 commissioner's plan for New York City. And one of the striking things about this plan is that it basically grids the island of Manhattan out north to south with almost no public space left in the middle of the island. Of course, the thing that changes this, that the kind of miracle that happens in New York, is Central Park. And I think that as a kind of grand idea that seemed maybe impossible at the time, you get this remarkable combination of the most valuable real estate along with this extraordinary public amenity out of this idea. This is, of course, an aerial view of the Northeast Corridor, and in thinking about this initially, I was struck by this sequence of all of the train stations along the Northeast Corridor and the fact that the as you go along the Northeast Corridor from Washington all the way to Boston, each of the train stations along this route is, in fact, its original great historic train station. There's Baltimore following Washington Union Station, Philadelphia 30th Street Station, Newark, of course, is in there, Boston South Street. But of course, the center of the whole thing is New York City, and this is what we have in New York City. And you know, it's like a kind of cruel joke, right, that we look at that and say that's the, and this is the busiest of all of the train stations on that. And of course, this is the interior experience of it, which many of you probably on a daily basis experience and great joy that we all have when we're down there. And this is a view of the site looking back towards it over the Farley Post Office towards the site as it is today. These are some renderings now of the Moynihan plan, which I think is an extraordinary achievement. And the fact that it's going ahead finally is really wonderful. The reality is we need both those blocks. And as a train station that serves more than 600,000 people a day, we really need all of that real estate dedicated to transit and trains. And you can see here the overall renderings of that proposal from above, which I think will be tremendously advantageous. And there's the street view of what we have with the garden sitting in the middle of it. So what did we lose when we lost the station? And some of the photographs show you that. Here's a view of rendering of the station from above with its great colonnades facing the 7th Avenue facade. And a street view of the same elevation gives you some idea of the presence of the building as they imagined it. It's inspired, of course, by these things, the great colonnades of St. Peter's in Rome, its enveloping arms, wonderful Tuscan columns, which were the direct model for the columns at Penn Station. And the plan of the station, where you can see the layout of the arcade all the way from 7th Avenue leading to the great waiting room, and then on to the train shed about beyond it, and the section through that gives you an idea of what that sequential experience was like going through the station. I was always curious about the relationship between Grand Central and Penn Station, and here's an image of Grand Central Station and the interior, of course, of that experience, the one that I had as a child and that all of you have going through it. It's a comparison drawing that we made showing the section of Grand Central, the elevation of Grand Central, sitting inside the Wayne waiting room. The whole building would fit effectively inside the great waiting room at Penn Station. It gives you an idea of the scale of it, 150 feet high to the roof, the height of the Pantheon in Rome, which inspired it, of course. And this gives you an idea of the original architectural vision for the site, showing the whole development of the post office, the train station, and developing it all the way out to Broadway with commercial as part of the original rendering, and the original entry from the 7th Avenue facade as you went into that great arcade that led you to the great waiting room. And here are images of the great waiting room itself, which some of you, in fact, actually remember. I wish I'd experienced this. The extraordinary light that falls into it. Really a great indoor-outdoor living room, effectively, like a piazza, effectively covered over. And a true public amenity on a scale that we have really nothing like anywhere in the country. And of course, the great train platform shed based on the great models in Europe. So this is what happened in 1963. Of course, the decision was made to tear it down. The building came down. It took 4 years to demolish the building, despite the protests of many prominent New Yorkers. This is the thing that really started the New York Landmarks movement. Inspired the preservation of so many other buildings, including Grand Central Station, of course, but wasn't able to save this building. And I don't know if you can see in the deck, my favorite sign here, this says, sorry, but close it we must to build your new station, as if somehow what was being built was going to give us something better than what was being taken away. So are there precedents for this? Are there other places where we've managed to do this? There are several of them, and I think they're important inspiring for us, because it shows you that something like this is in fact achievable and something we could look to as an example. This is, of course, Dresden, an aerial view of Dresden. And as we know, it was firebombed and completely destroyed at the end of the Second World War, and was amazingly rebuilt, in fact, with money that was raised largely in this country as well as in Europe. And today, this is what it looks like. And another example, of course, the city of Warsaw, which was also badly destroyed during the war, firebombed, and again reconstructed. So there are very direct precedents for this kind of thing in other parts of the world. This is my favorite example. Those of you who have been to Moscow, this is the great Cathedral of Christ the Savior. Was blown up under Stalin and turned into one of the largest outdoor swimming pools in the world, which people thought was actually unlucky to swim in, particularly during thunderstorms. And in the 1990s, the cathedral was rebuilt. And there it is today. Of course, Denver has repurposed its historic train station as well, and it's a tremendous success, and it sits at the end of the light rail line now from the airport and provides a wonderful, an extraordinary experience coming into the city and really a kind of a living room for the city in the middle. These are some renderings of current proposals that I think are less than inspired and in the end are probably not the direction that really we would want to go in if we could really create a great public building. The first one, of course, is the rendering from the 8th Avenue facade, putting the entrance back still down into the ground under the garden. This, of course, a treatment for the facade of Toupin Plaza by Big, called the Maryland, with its curving glass elevations. And these are renderings of the Moynihan Train Hall, which I think actually are inspiring and definitely give us a sense of what, you know, could be back on this site if we rebuilt the original station as well. There's a view of the SOM rendering of the interior. So this is a drawing that I made many years ago that got started this idea of rebuilding the station. This was a rendering of the facade of the Farley Building, with the vaults of the original Penn Station set up above it, and it's the thing that started me thinking about the idea of the possibility of rebuilding the building. And some digital recreations of the interior of the building. I think one of the ways to begin this would be to create a good digital model of the whole building and get a sense of the experience of the thing and do digital fly-throughs of the building. And these are the images of our train ads, which went up last fall, and we're on the, New Jersey Transit line that talk about the spaces to inspire, the station we deserve. And finally, a set of holiday windows that we put up last year where we were talking about the inspiration for this project. So the question is, could you actually rebuild this today? And I think the answer is yes, the technology exists to put this back. This is South Street, or 9 West Street, excuse me, being reconstructed after 9/11. All of the cast iron facade going up. The cast iron reconstruction of the dome of the Capitol building in Washington, D.C. And some plans that we drew up just as a kind of an exercise with some students for the urban environment around the station and what we might look like with the potential for an exterior public space around it. And some digital images of what that building might look like put back in the space as it was before. And finally, an image of the plan of the station with the square to the north that we think would enhance the whole public experience to have an exterior public space in relation to this as well. So this is an image of the building going up when it was going up originally, but the idea is that that could once again be a construction project on 7th Avenue with this building going up. And that instead of the experience that we have today on the left, we'd have the experience we have originally on the right, arriving once again into this glorious building. And the idea of this is the once and future station. Thank you.
We would be happy to take questions for a few moments or minutes or however long it takes. Yes, Lucas.
My question is, what is the attitude of the existing stakeholders, the governors of the individual states and towards the idea of a through station rather than a terminal station, and who gets to set the requirements for the design of the station itself?
They're asking themselves, who are those guys?
when they think of us. But I will let Barry give you some thoughts about it. I think there's a lot of groups thinking about what to do with a station. There is not a lot of money that people are envisioning to do this. And I think it's going to take a breakthrough in thinking. The good news for us is there will be a couple of RFPs coming out about doing some things to the station. I don't think they will be as bold as what we want. I also don't think they will preclude what we would like to do. We need to build some awareness and get people into a different gear. I think that we have met with a lot of key stakeholders, and there are some that support us publicly. There's some that can't support us publicly, but have almost to a person said, we hope you guys somehow pull it off, largely because they'll become a lot wealthier. But they also say that they'd like their grandchildren to be able to go through this building. But I'll let Barry give you a little sense of the politics as well.
Sure. So I'm just going to try to get out of the way of that so there's not interference. We've been meeting for the last 18 months with the federal, state, local officials and decision makers about this. The concept of through running is not entirely new. In fact, what is sort of different about our proposal is that we started with a white paper that Amtrak put together in 2014 that looked at the real technical obstacles to doing through running, because it's been a long-term goal of all three railroads in the region for a long time. What they haven't been able to figure out is how to actually get it done. And so what we've done is we've actually looked through with that proposal, with that white paper as a starting point, and said, how do you overcome these real technical obstacles, like the trains run on different kinds of electric power in Long Island versus New Jersey. They have different platform heights. Not all of the platforms in New Jersey are high level. You have to use stairs at some of them, that sort of stuff. Where are you going to park the trains during the day? Where are you going to put the yard space? So sort of all of that sort of nitty-gritty, when we met with the head of NJ Transit, that was one of the things they really appreciated about our proposal, was that we'd really thought through a lot of those details. So what we're looking at doing is trying to push this forward in a way that is sort of acceptable to all of the key stakeholders. Because one of the things to note is that already right now, there are agreements to effectively do bi-state operating agreements for certain lines. The Port Jervis line on Metro North, which is technically Metro North, but runs with NJ Transit to Hoboken. Same with the Pascack Valley line. The state of Connecticut has a contract with Metro North to operate the New Haven line. So these are all sort of models that we've been looking at, pointing out these are certainly real issues to overcome. But there are ways to do it, and we've come up with ways, we think, to achieve that.
Yes, sir.
Hi. My question has to do with this. If this, the new rebuilt Penn Station, how would it comply with the Americans with Disabilities Act, as well as you mentioned briefly Homeland Security, another concern would probably also be now in the post 9/11 world.
Yeah, I think that the thing about the building, the original building, is it was phenomenally adaptable to contemporary standards. I mean, first of all, the scale of the building was such that there was you could change many of the stairways into ramps and provide access given the length of things in and out of the building. There's a ton of sort of internal poche space in which you could, you know, accommodate elevators and all of those things that you would need in order to make the ADA requirements work. And in terms of Homeland Security, I mean, I think we've given some thought to that. I mean, obviously, the original carriageways that went down the sides, you know, are probably not practical at this point and probably not necessary, which is why we proposed converting them into colonnades, exterior arcades, really, for the public.
Hi, thanks. Two questions. You mentioned a through station. would the definition of a through station be something like what the Secaucus Junction is in Secaucus, New Jersey, where the trains go through? It's not an end stop. It's like they're going through to other places. So I assume you're using the Penn Station not as an end stop where they just, you know, sit in the yards. They're going to be moving interstate constantly. So I'm assuming you're using the Secaucus Junction as that was used as a model. That's one question. The other question is, in terms of trying to revive an interest in classical architecture in general to get this project going, you're going to have to do that. You're going to have to influence the tastes of the powers that be who have loads of money to spend on this kind of stuff so that they love classical architecture and want to push it. And it's reviving a whole vocabulary. It's reviving a whole series of crafts. So I think there's that aspect of it as well. If you're involved in it in some way, shape, or form, I know you have the Classical Architects of America, you have these groups. And hopefully they're part of it also. Thank you.
I'll quickly, just because it's super quick. Yes, a through station means there's at least one stop afterwards. In some cases, there would be just one stop because you don't need the same volume of trains running in reverse peak service as peak service. But yes, there's at least one stop after Penn Station, as in every Secaucus Junction and every other station other than Penn Station.
On the architecture point, I'll let Richard give you his viewpoint, since he helped found the Institute for Classical Architecture. But what I want to say is, my wife and I rebuilt our house in arts and crafts style, and we like various types of architecture. But before I hand it to Richard, I would say, and I think I alluded to in my presentation, we think that the type of architecture that you find at Grand Central and Baltimore Station and Washington's Union Station, for some reason, is particularly well suited for railroad stations and as a community public space. And unless you're going to do something that is better than that and works better than that, we don't see any reason, particularly here, where we would be redefining urban renewal by taking a station built at the beginning of the 20th century and retrofitting it for this century using the architecture that's proven the test of time with a track plan that's very modern. We think it's a combination that is very compelling. But I don't want to deny the classicists their chance at the mic. So, Richard?
Well, I mean, we've been making this argument since we founded the Institute almost 30 years ago. And, I think that it's really a question, ultimately, of what the, representative public good is. And I think in this case, there are two things to say. One is that the building itself is a remarkable work of art, one of the greatest buildings in the world, arguably, certainly one of the greatest in North America. And that the inspiration that you get from a building like that is just not replicable in contemporary architectural vocabulary, whether it's glass and steel or whatever, the latest version of that is. The kind of humanist value that inspires us when we go through Grand Central, is the same thing that we would find at Penn Station. I also think that the whole point of the achievement of that kind of style was that to aim for something that was more permanent and longer lasting. It wasn't really a question of a contemporary fashion, but something that, although Penn Station lived only for 50 years, it was inspired by models that were 2,000 years old. And I think that's why, for instance, that people still find the inspiration in those buildings when they go to Washington. So I think that there's an argument to be made that in the end, while it may not be the only way to go about building things, it's certainly the one that inspires us the most, and particularly in terms of the public good.
Yeah, and just before, and we will take more questions, some of you as you leave, there's a McKim, Mead & White station. There is a beautiful McKim, Mead & White building that's right behind us, which is the Racquet and Tennis Club. Especially if you cross Park Avenue and look back, it's worth taking a second and third look at. But you've been waiting patiently.
Thank you. What's financing this effort and all of your efforts? What or who?
If you are on my wedding list, you've gotten a lot of letters asking for funding. We do have some big donors, but we're as happy to crowdfund as anyone. And as I told you, we were very welcome to get our most recent check from Dale Parent, and a lot of forces came together to help us put this event on. You know, we had a quality budget last year, and we're hoping to have a bigger budget this year. Excuse me? Oh, Rethink. Okay. That's a separate question. So they have the Venturi effect, but I'll let Barry get to that.
Yeah, we have a wealthy benefactor who came up with the original concept of this idea that those of us who work in the studio have been refining since. He's still funding us. We're in the process of setting up a nonprofit to be able to take contributions. But as of right now, we have a single wealthy benefactor who loves the concept.
Thank you.
Thanks, Ed. It's great talking about the end results of what all this is going to be, recreating the beautiful building and all. What type of marketing plan, what type of public relations plan, what type of on-the-ground type of business development, thank you, that you have come up with, and there are people that could probably come in and help you.
We talk about that a great deal. Justin works quite hard on that, as all of us do. We are involved with a pro bono consultant who does this sort of thing and is helping us put together a strategic plan and marketing plan. We have some folks who've recently affiliated with us who have those backgrounds, and we certainly are all ears at moving up the food chain in terms of the types of tools and folks that we have access to. Richard or Justin, do you want to add to that?
Well, I'll just say already we've received a great deal of attention, much of it thanks to these advertisements which we put on New Jersey Transit trains and platforms, Architectural Digest, Wall Street Journal, all sorts of magazines have come out in support of the plan. And so, you know, we think given what we've been able to achieve already, we could achieve so much more with, you know, a true strategic and business plan of the sort you mentioned. Yes, exactly. The developer, I mean, this is such an enormous project that we need civic leaders, the real estate, leaders, all sorts of people like this to get on board for it to actually happen.
I would just say we're hoping for a tipping point, and we think we're moving in that direction. We would not say we're there yet.
There may be no elephant in the room anymore now that the circus is gone, but the key thing is that there is a 100 billion ton gorilla sitting in that space, namely Madison Square Garden. And while their operating permit expires in 5 years, until the problem of moving the garden gets resolved, all of the discussion about the building, not the tracks and the run-through, but about the building itself can't be resolved. The garden killed the previous plans. I worked for Senator Moynihan, and he tore his hair out trying to figure out some way to get the garden moved to actually rebuild the station or build a new station. And without a move of the garden, which is a powerful player in New York City finance and commerce and politics, I don't see what you can do.
Well, we hear you loud and clear, and every week of this journey we realize what the real and who the real power brokers in New York City are, and certainly the Dolans have exerted a great deal of influence on this city. But we are a great city and region, and I do not think one person should be allowed to insist that his basketball arena sit on top of a strategic site. So we are going to have to raise awareness, and people are going to have some courage and say, this was a mistake, that that was made in 19, it was a mistake to tear the building down. It was a triple mistake to put that thing on top of it. And there is no logic to having this there. And to the extent the governor or anybody else is telling us to try and nip around the edges, remove the Hulu Theater and we'll put a glass wall on 8th Avenue, which, by the way, all the other plans, their renderings, frame the Farley Post Office. They use McKim, Mead & White architecture to sell plans that aren't McKim, Mead & White architecture. But as to the power brokers, you know, we're inspired by the High Line. We're inspired by Jane Jacobs. We're inspired by so many others. And I told you at the start, I ain't giving up. And, you know, so, you know, it ain't a fair fight, but I ain't giving up.
Yeah, the other thing is that the garden almost moved back in 2007, 2008. I mean, within, you know, weeks, basically. And the reality is it's all about money, you know, and it, fundamentally it's about a tax incentive that they have for being there. You know, they get, I don't know what it is now, but it's, you know, the order of $70 or $80 million. If someone changed that tax incentive and made a better tax incentive to go somewhere else, they'd move in a second, you know? Right. The old Morgan Annex, right, yeah.
Right. The reference was just made to the Morgan Post Office, which is a huge two-block, super-block site, 29th to 27th Street, I believe 9th to 10th Avenue. It would be an appropriate site. And look, it is very close to the new 7 extension, and it is very close to Penn Station. And so some seasoned ticket holders won't be able to get on trains as quickly. I am a long-suffering Knicks season ticket holder. Please don't tell the Dolans, because if they add 2 and 2, I will no longer be a season ticket holder. But it's a plenty convenient location. Sir, and then one more question. Does that make sense? And then we'll go see the photo exhibit and the refreshments. Yes, sir.
Thank you for your excellent presentation. This is a bit of a follow-up to the previous question. I think Vornado is thinking of repurposing the west end of the Farley building as a biotech facility. Given that, how realistic do you think that Madison Square Garden will ever move? That's the prime location for them to move, and that may not be possible.
They are, yeah, the Morgan Library.
No, no, yeah, but the west end of the Farley building.
Well,
is...
it's unfortunate. It is unfortunate that decision was made. And the garden would have moved back there. There were some landmark concerns and some other concerns. It's just unfortunate, and the city got shortchanged by that decision. So we'll hopefully the Morgan is one of the few sites left that would work, but you know, we'll want to see. One more question.
Hi, I have two questions. One of them is about, have you guys done the economic impact of making it a thorough station on Queens and on the New York City area, and what will that economic impact be over like a short and long term, medium and long term? And the second thing is, I think Justin mentioned at the beginning something about democracy and the choice of buildings. Can you expand a little bit about that, about this public space, and how is that connected to democracy and just like from a philosophical point of view? Thanks.
So just quickly on the economic impact of through running, the answer is it's immense. It's an immense economic impact on the region. To give you a sense of scale, the LIRR is spending several billion dollars on what they call the third track, which is to allow them to run increased reverse peak service on the main line. Right now, you basically can't commute from Midtown, from Queens, to Long Island at rush hour. You can only go in the peak direction because of the need to run express trains. This is a multi-billion dollar project that would change that. That is projected to add tens of thousands of jobs and hundreds of thousands of residents just by allowing you to run some additional reverse peak service. This would put that on steroids. You look at the East Bronx Metro North proposal, Penn Station Access proposal, that they project millions of new rides a year, significant transit-oriented development. When we speak to the Bronx Chamber of Commerce about what it would mean to them to be on a line that had a one-seat ride to Newark Airport and a quick two-seat ride to JFK with access to all three suburban areas, their eyes go as wide as you can imagine. It's same in Queens. It's an enormous, enormous change for the entire tri-state region. Talk to Westchester, talk to Newark, talk to White Plains, talk to New Rochelle, talk to Mineola. It would allow you to do so much development at those stations. And that would have an additional major environmental benefit if you can push development in the New York region towards a more transit-oriented model.
Yeah, I mean, I'll answer at least from my point of view. I mean, I think in terms of the relationship to democracy, I mean, obviously, the most straightforward answer has to do with the founding of this particular democracy and the buildings in Washington, which were inspired by ancient Roman and Greek models, which is where democracy has its origins. So that's a kind of, political philosophy answer at some level. But I think also that, at a deeper level, there's a kind of human dimension to the classical architecture that was built in. And what I mean by that is the relationship between the elements of the building, the human body, the way we see ourselves projected onto a larger scale. So there's a kind of a spiritual projection of the architecture onto a grander, aggrandizing ourselves as individuals into a larger political world. And that's really what classical architecture represents at its most fundamental level. So through the figural aspects of it.
Yeah. Okay. Okay, well, you've all been very patient, and we would now like you to get a sense of the station's last years and join us in front of Chartwell Books for some libations and food. We'd like to once again thank Barry Singer, who, if Penn Station was an iconic train station, Barry Singer is an iconic independent bookstore owner and so much more. So thank you, Barry, and please do join us, and thank you for being here.